recording on my computer as well. Today I can hear you, so if you have any question, you can straight away ask. Okay, if you have any question from yesterday's class also, you can ask me. Guys, any question from yesterday's class? IPsec site-to-site VPN on checkpoint? Okay, let me see who's come. So we'll start it now. Where is the slide going? Okay, so what is clustering? Basically, it's a high availability solution where you have, you know, if any of the VPN, if one of the checkpoint firewall goes down, you can basically still be continuing with your operations because you have other members out there, right? So the solution is actually known as Cluster XL and is a software-based load sharing mechanism. Load sharing or high availability, you have a choice. That will distribute the network traffic between cluster of redundant security gateways. That means you require a couple of security gateways which will have similar properties, right? So they need to have similar property. That is another core requirement, which means they should have the same model, same number of interfaces, same number of other things, as etc. Okay. Now let's see what are, so there are two solutions basically available. We have high availability and load sharing. Cluster XL provides transparent failover in case of machine failures, zero downtime for mission critical environments, enhanced throughput because you can have load sharing, which means multiple gateways simultaneously are passing the traffic. And you can have upgrades of the cluster itself rather than individual devices. In load sharing, what happens is there are two mechanisms. You have multicast mode or unicast mode. We are going to see it in more detail, but there are two models that you have in load sharing. In high availability, you have two modes again, new mode and the legacy mode. In new mode, each member will have its own physical IP address. And in the legacy mode, which is no more supported in R80.10, you will basically have both members are going to have same physical IP address. This was, I think, up to R77 or something. It was working, right? So now you have new mode available where you will have each member is going to have his own physical address, and they will also have a virtual address which will represent them. Synchronization is very important. Checkpoint uses a one protocol. It's called a CCP protocol, basically cluster control protocol, which works on UDP 8116, and it by default bypasses the firewall rules. CCP is a L2 protocol, and so that means basically you can't put a router in between. You can't put any layer 3 device. That also means that all the devices that you have, which are going to be part of a gateway or cluster, needs to be on the same L2 segment, right? Which also means they need to be same IP address. They should be in the same VLAN or they should be in the same subnet, right? So that's a requirement. Why? Because CCP is a L2 protocol. Each cluster member must have a security gateway and an acceleration and clustering blade. License, okay, so that is another requirement, and all the gateways should have same time, similar time. So you generally should use NTP so that you have the right time synchronization between each of the gateways. What are the requirements for gateways to become part of a cluster? All cluster members must run identically configured platforms. So that means if one has R80.10, another should have R80.10. Right, so all the gateways in the cluster, so maximum 8 checkpoint gateways can be part of a single cluster. max of 8 gateways can be part of single cluster. Depending on you are using high availability or load sharing, you can choose what is that you want to basically implement, right? All cluster member must have same checkpoint software version. They should have exactly same hardware version. So if you are using virtual platform with physical platform, if you are using one of the physical platform, let's say 3110, the other needs to be 3110. If one has 6 interfaces, the other should also have 6 interfaces. If one of the platform has 8 interfaces, then the other should have 8 interfaces. Plus the configuration of them should be identical. Okay, the configuration of them should be identical, which we will see. Anyways, we will be forced to have an identical configuration. If a cluster member goes down, user authenticated connections through that member are lost. Other cluster members cannot restore the connection. Client authenticated or session authenticated patients are maintained, but not the user. So there are certain limitations also which are there, which are not in our control because those are platform limitations. So there are two modes available basically in clustering, right? In the load sharing mechanism, you have multicast and unicast, and both modes differ in a way. A member receives the packet and sent to the cluster. So in the multicast mechanism, what happens is it works on basically the L2 mechanism. So you can see that it works on Ethernet network layer, allows several interfaces to be associated with a single MAC address. Okay, which means if you have, let's say, 8 gateways, or let me design it here. Let's say if you have 1, 2, 3, 4, you can have 2 or more, which means you can have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, up to 8 gateways are basically supported. You can have any number between 2, minimum 2 numbers are required to have a cluster. So let's say I'm putting this as a cluster, correct? I'm putting this as a cluster. So what will happen in this is that any kind of traffic coming to these 8, and they need to be on the same subnet, okay? So they all need to be, let's say this is the internal interface connected to maybe single switch, okay? They're all connected to single switch. So they should be on the same subnet. Let's say put it subnet as 10.1.1.0/24. So all the hosts here are going to send the traffic, and depending on the more that we are using, right now we are talking about load sharing. We are not talking about high availability, which is the second mode. We are not talking about it right now. We are talking about load sharing mechanism at this time. So what will happen in load sharing is you have two modes, the multicast and unicast. Okay, so what happens is all these 8 interfaces are actually representing, right, or have adopted a single virtual MAC address. Yes, yes, I'll take care of that, Setu. Right, so what will happen in multicast mode here is that they are all going to adapt a single MAC address. We will again go and first we'll finish the theory and then we will look at it. So allow several interfaces to be associated with a single physical MAC address. Unlike broadcast, which binds all interfaces in the same subnet to a single address, multicast enables grouping within the networks. So you can have multiple groups also created if you want to create, okay? This means that it is possible to select interface with a single subnet that will receive packet sent to the given MAC address, okay? Cluster XL uses multicast mechanism to associate virtual IP addresses with all cluster members by binding these IP addresses to multicast MAC address. It will ensure that all packets sent to the cluster acting as a gateway will reach to all members in the cluster. Okay, each member then decide whether it should process the packet or not. The decision is the core of the load sharing mechanism. it has to assure that at least one member will process the packet, so traffic is not blocked. Okay, so what is happening here is that the traffic which is reaching, let's say I'll give you a multicast address, so I'm not sure what is the multicast address being used there, but let's say I use this multicast address for sending the traffic to everybody there, and then there is a multicast MAC address also. So it could be any multicast MAC address in the multicast range, right? So all the traffic that is being sent to the virtual IP, it is going to get mapped to, so let's say your gateway of for the host, because host doesn't know you are using multicast and host doesn't send multicast traffic, right? Host receives multicast traffic. So the host thinks, let's say that you, their gateway is this, or maybe 254. For this subnet, this is the gateway. For this particular subnet, this is the gateway. For all the hosts basically are thinking or sending the traffic to this address. And this address basically is in the background, has a multicast group associated to it. So the traffic is being sent to this multicast group. And this multicast group in the background is connected to a multicast MAC address, virtual MAC address, right? This is your virtual VIP, and the traffic is then multicasted. Why is it multicasted? So that all the 8 people receive a copy of the packet to be forwarded to the internet. Because this is, let's say, your outside subnet. This is your outside interface. Correct? So from inside subnet, any packet comes, it will be sent to everybody. That's the multicast way of talking. Okay? Now, this creates a problem that there is a possibility of duplication. The two people process the packet, and there is also a possibility of nobody doing it, so some kind of drop can happen. Now, for that, checkpoint has, the cluster XL is what they call it, has its own algorithms to take care of that. So once a packet is forwarded from one particular host for, you know, from one client, it will always pass through this particular client. It's single connection, right? In a single connection, you can have huge number of packets. But if a new connection opens from this host, let's say there is a host here, which is 10.1.1.2, and he is first going to yahoo.com, so maybe he's adopting this path, okay? Which is decided by whom? The cluster XL protocol decides, they among themselves decides who will, based on certain algorithms, based on certain hash mechanisms, they will decide who will take the packet, right? So let's say this guy decides, or this guy has no choice, right? The algorithm decides that he will go through the checkpoint number CP2, let's call it, right? And all traffic to yahoo.com is passing through this. Now, after that, this guy decides to go through google.com or gmail.com, right? So here CP7 will basically, let's say algorithm decide that he will go through CP7. So that's a new connection that you have. Okay, because you are opening a new connection, right? See, your connection means your source and destinations. So your source was this, the destination was yahoo.com. So that's a different IP altogether. Now you're opening a new connection. So basically your source is some different and the destination is again different. Or source may be same, the destination is different. So it will be counted as a new connection. It cannot be new, right? It can't be a new packet. It has to be a new connection. Now, all packets passing through this connection in the part of a connection will be called packets. Packets being passing through single connection, right? So this is the mechanism basically being used in case of multicasting, where all the host will receive because the virtual IP is mapped to a multicast address in the background. For this, you have to make sure the switch that you have, this switch, right, should support IGMP. Because if you do not have IGMP support or other protocol support for multicasting at layer 2, what will happen? Your packet will be dropped because multicast is not supported at L2 then. So make sure you have that. Okay, it reaches to all the members. Each member then decides whether it should process the packet or not. The decision is the core of the load sharing mechanism, which is the algorithm. It also has to assure that at least one member will process the packet and that no two members will handle the same packet, so the packet is not duplicated. Correct? Now, what happens in case of unicast? So load sharing unicast mode provides a load sharing solution adopted to environments where multicast Ethernet cannot operate. What could be those places? Maybe the switch doesn't have IGMP enabled or CGMP enabled. CGMP is Cisco proprietary, so IGMP is the only choice that we have, right? Or maybe they are connected through hub or something else. So the switch, it's not a switch, it's a hub. In this mode, a single cluster member referred to as pivot is associated with cluster's virtual IP and thus is thus the only member to receive packets sent to cluster. The pivot is then responsible for propagating the packet to other cluster members, creating a load sharing mechanism. Distribution is performed by applying a decision function on each packet, same way it is done in the load sharing multicast mechanism. Now, the process has changed. In multicasting, the traffic was actually sent to the group, and all the group members who have subscribed to the group were receiving the packet. It's like a WhatsApp group. Okay? But here in unicast, what is happening is it is going to go to the boss, the pivot, right? It is going to go to the pivot, which is actually the boss here. So, and then further, he will decide who else to send the packet to. He can act as a pivot. At the same time, he can be active gateway, which means that he is doing, he's taking part in the traffic forwarding process, right? Or he can act only as a boss, which means he will be the deciding factor of where to send the traffic to, right? Shall I send it to CP2 or CP3 or CP4? And he will decide, right? So these are two different mechanisms, how the traffic is basically distinguished, how the traffic will basically be forwarded. Guys, any question on this? In multicasting, what is happening is the traffic is sent to the multicast group, and because everybody is part of the group, no choice, they will all receive the packet. But the algorithm will decide who can forward the traffic to the internet. In unicast mode, there is a guy called pivot. All the traffic will be sent to him, and then the pivot will decide, right, that whether he wants to send the traffic to CP2 or CP3 or CP4, right? So they, in multicasting, what was happening is they were all deciding. In unicast, what happens is one guy decides. So it's like in organizations, right? Where you have a manager and he is basically the deciding authority, or you have a boss who's the deciding authority, right? So these are two different mechanisms. Guys, any question on this? For multicasting, make sure you have underlying infrastructure ready, like the switch that you have should support the IGMP basically. In both the cases, the virtual IP will be used and virtual MAC address will be used because the traffic is still going to be sent to the virtual IP. But once you send in multicast mode, you send the traffic to virtual IP, it will go to everybody. And in unicast, when you send the traffic to the virtual IP, it will go to one guy who's called pivot. He will decide further based on the algorithm that how internally the traffic has to be distributed. He will keep a table and he can also participate as active himself, which means he can be part of forwarding decision. Sorry, he can be part of forwarding itself, not only the decision. The decision he is making, that's correct. But he is forwarding real traffic or not, that is basically what has to be seen. So here it is. The difference is only one member performs this selection. Any non-pivot member, which means not the boss, right, that receives a forward packet will handle it without applying decision function. Note that the non-pivot members are still considered as active, since they perform routing and firewall tasks on a share of the traffic, but they do not perform decisions. Right? So this is the major change that you have in unicast and multicast mode. In unicast mode, there is only one boss who decides, and in multicast mode, it's basically the algorithm. All of them decide who will basically participate, who's going to take this particular packet, and then further all the connection, all the traffic from that packet will go through that particular guy. Okay, even though the pivot memory is responsible for the decision process, it still acts as a security gateway that processes the packet. So yes, it is acting as a boss, but it is also taking the workload. So it is also participating as one of the active members who's also doing the additional task. However, since this additional task can be time consuming, it is usually assigned a smaller share of the total load. Now, because it is doing other tasks, right, being the pivot or the boss, he will be assigned a less share of the total load. When a failover event occurs in a non-pivot member, it handled connections are redistributed between active cluster members, providing the same high availability capabilities of new high availability and load sharing multicast. When the pivot member encounter a problem, a regular failover event occurs, and in addition, another member assumes the role of the pivot, right? So if the boss fails, then there is an election process. Correct? If the boss fails, then there is an election process. But if one of the members is failing, that there is no election process, the rest of the people will take care of the redistribution of the load. This means that when a former pivot comes back, it will retain its previous role. Okay? The pivot member is always the active member with the highest priority. So in the cluster, the one who's going to become the boss should have the highest priority. Then we are going to do the lab. I will show you how to see the priorities and increase the priority or decrease the priorities. Now, there are, as we talked about, the legacy mode and the new mode. So here it is. Cluster XL new high availability mode designates one of the cluster members as active machine, while the other members remain in standby mode. So what are we talking about? We are talking about high availability mode. What were the other things, two things we were talking about before? We were talking about load sharing, right? So load sharing is what we were talking about. Now, what are we talking about? We are talking about, right now we are talking about high availability. You do not have those problems of multicast and unicast in high availability, because there is no question of load sharing, right? So now again, in high availability, again, you can have up to 8 members. So let's say this is your cluster. Inside your cluster, you have 8 members. But what happens in HA? Only one member will be actively forwarding the traffic at one time, okay? So even if you have all these guys connected to a switch and there are users here, but only one of them is going to be active who will be forwarding the traffic. And rest of them are going to sit at standby. So no question of load sharing. High availability is never load sharing. It's like high availability, right? It's just for the purpose of failover, not load sharing. So in load sharing, you have two mechanisms, multicast and unicast. In high availability, there is nothing like that. In high availability, basically you have two modes, new mode and the legacy mode. Okay. In new mode, what happens is, which is heavily used these days, new mode, you will have a virtual IP. Okay. You will have a virtual IP, and each of these guys are going to have their own unique IP. In legacy mode, what used to happen is, so let me write it here. In the new mode, VIP plus individual IPs. IPs are being used. In legacy, what used to happen is, they used to have same IP on both or the different host, all the host. They used to have same IP. It's not supported. There were a lot of limitations. There were a lot of issues. So what is supported right now is the new mode. They will have their individual IP, but they will be sharing the distributed virtual IP for communication between them, or for, you know, purpose of replying to ARP and everything else. Guys, Any question, any doubt on this? Right, so let's understand this again. So high availability, we have legacy and new mode and load sharing. We discuss about unicast and multicasting. Okay, we already know what is the mechanism here. There was a concept of this is all equals, right? So it's all equals. Here we have a pivot deciding further sharing between members, between active members. So these were two mechanisms. Let's see if we have another slide here. So here it is. So cluster XL new high availability mode designates one of the cluster member as active machine while the other members remain in the standby mode. The cluster XL virtual IPs are associated with physical network interface of the active machine. Active, when say machine, it means checkpoint gateway, right? So each time the word machine comes in, it's an active gateway. By matching the virtual IP with the unique MAC address of appropriate interface, thus all traffic directed at the cluster is actually routed by the active member. The role of each cluster member is chosen according to its priority, with the active member being the one of the highest ranking guy in the group. So one who is going to forward the traffic is going to be active member. And because we are talking about high availability, only one active member is possible at this time. Rest of the members are going to be standby members, right? And they are the low priority members. One with the highest ranking is going to be the member, the active member basically. And he will be forwarding the traffic. Member priorities correspond to the order in which they appear in the cluster members page of the gateway cluster priorities window. The topmost member has the highest priority. Okay, you can modify this ranking at any time. So that's the last slide we have here. Okay, so how does the process work? The process is very simple. How do you do the lab? Right, so you know all the theoretical parameters that they should be same software version, same hardware, same updates, and member of same cluster. Now further, what will happen is once these guys become member of a cluster, right? All policies. Now let me show you here in the design itself. Think about it. If let's say you have four gateways here, so how many security policies, guys, are you going to have? If you have four gateways, how many security policies are you going to have? Right? Now, once it is part of a cluster, what will happen is there will be only one policy because they will not be acting as four different firewalls, four different gateways. They are going to act as what? One single cluster. So whatever you are going, whenever you are going to make a firewall policy, it is going to be single firewall policy. Whatever changes you do will not be saved to the individual firewall, which will be saved to the gateway itself. Okay. So now how does it work? So first you have to go to CLI. Okay. And on the implementation side, first go to CLI and put them as cluster member. This has to be done at CLI. Okay. The second thing you have to do is then you can go to Smart Console and add them to cluster. You have to create a cluster name and add it to the cluster. These are the two requirements. The third requirement you have is then create VIP and port states. We are going to see the port state. There will be cluster port, there will be sync port, there will be monitor port, there will be other port types. You're going to see that. Okay. So let me see if all our gateways are up and running. In the meantime, I'll try to do SSH to them. This is from yesterday's configuration. And we have two gateways and two policies. Remember that. We have two gateways with two different policies. All that has to change. So 172.16.2.200 and 202. I'm going to do SSH to them. To do the step one. 172.16.2.200. Okay, so here you see that, the option. Now guys, for clustering to work, you should be in the distributed mode. Remember that, if any of your gateway is in the standalone mode, it will not work. It will only work in distributed mode. That's a prime requirement. You choose the number 6, so enable the clustering. Do you want to do that? Yes, I want to. This change will take effect only after reboot, remember that. This change will take effect only after the reboot. So I'm going to say reboot. You want to do that? Yes. Done. Now we'll go to the second gateway. 172.16.2.202. And enable it here. You want to do that? Yes. And reboot. So both gateways are rebooting. There is no need for my Smart Console to reboot because that's just a management server. These gateways have to reboot. Once they come back, we will see how to add them to cluster. We will create a cluster here and put them as part of one cluster. I'll open my ESXi so that I know that they have come back. CP1, let's check the console. What's going on? Coming back, okay. CP2, let's check the console. So step one is happening. Put them into cluster member using CP config command option number 6. Right? Enable clustering, which is basically what is it? The option was enable. Now here I don't have an option to choose what kind of cluster I want and all that. It's just simple enabling. That option will be here in step two, right? So this is step one. In step two, what will happen is I will have a choice to put them as multicast or unicast or high availability or load sharing all those things. I will have load sharing, which means active, right? Means all like gateways active, or I will have high availability. In load sharing, you have two mechanisms, right? Unicast and multicast. In high availability, you used to have new mode. We have new mode and legacy mode. It used to be there, but no load sharing here. In high availability, there is no possibility of load sharing. So these are basically the different types we have. All these choices we will get in step two. Step two. Then we have step number three, which is creating the virtual IPs and setting the port states. This is a three-step process. That's all. It's a very easy process. And you will see when we see the options also, it's very easy to implement it. So let's see if our gateways are okay. One gateway is back. Let's see the other one. That is also back. So what do we do quickly? We create a cluster. Right? What is the cluster name? I'll just say cluster one. What is the IP you want to give to cluster management IP? I'll say 172.16.2.201. You want to use IPv6? No, I'm not using it. Here I have my options. Okay, here I have my options. Are you going to use, you want to do with third party gateways and all that? No. And are you using old versions of this? No. Are you using VRRP? No, I'm not using it. Basically, I'm using CCP protocol. You want to do high availability or load sharing? First, I'll do high availability, then we'll try to change it to load sharing. Okay. So this will be high availability. Okay. And what are your gateways? I have two gateways, CP11 and CP12. The gateway cannot be added to this cluster since it is used in places where cluster members are not allowed. Okay. What could be those? Because those are, let me go back to those things. I'm just going to remove because they already have their individual VPNs. So it says you are using it in the VPN community. I'm going to remove the VPN community. Delete this one. Okay, no. So I'll just go inside the community, remove the gateways, remove both of them, then remove the community. Okay, community is using firewall rules. So I have to go to firewall rule, delete the rule itself. Because these rules have no sense because they are for individual firewalls. So I have to delete the rule itself. One rule has to be basically there. I can just remove all this. Okay, my standard policy also, I have to do the same thing. Because this rule is applied there also. So in the rule also, it's gone. Now I'll try to delete my community because there is no dependency. Correct? That's being removed. And I'm going to save this thing now. Which policy do you want to do that? I want to do standard. And what do you want to do that? I want to install on both. Because now both gateways are going to be part of single cluster. So do you want to do that? Yeah, why not? Now, can they have two different policies because they are different gateways? No. because they are part of single cluster, their inside interfaces all are same. For this user sitting here, whatever subnets you have on inside, they don't know that you are four. They have no idea that your guys are four. To them, you are one single cluster with one virtual IP, whatever virtual IP from the same subnet. They don't have any idea that you guys are four or what. Okay, policy failed. Cluster is empty, so policy will not go there. That's fine. Cluster is okay, so let's go back to there. First, I'm going to remove the cluster that we created because we do not have anything there. So delete it. Now we go and save the policies. Pick up single policy, apply on both of them. Remember that the configuration to everything else, version, hardware, software, configuration has to be exactly same, right? So successful installation, they both have the same this thing. Now, if we go and add clustering, cluster one, 172.16.2.20.1. Okay, asking me to add the gateways. Can I add now? Cool. We come in few seconds. Right, okay. Now I'm going to add CP12. If you add CP12 to the cluster, it will be converted to a cluster member. Some of the setting will be lost, like your SIC. The following setting will still remain SIC, VPN, NAT, except for IP pools. These settings are going to be, rest of all other settings will be removed. Do you want to continue? Yes. So both the gateways are there. I'll go ahead and do next. Okay. Now, which interface do you want to use for the clustering or for synchronization? And if you don't want to monitor it, that's also okay. So let's go into theory of that. So I'm going to pick up at two firewalls at this time to show you what is the meaning of all those different interface types. Okay, so this is your CP11 and this is your CP12. Okay, so first interface you have here is that, do you want to monitor these interfaces? Are they going to participate in clustering interfaces or in the clustering? So you say yes. Okay. So this is going to be your inside interfaces are going to participate in clustering. This will also participate because these are interface. So there will be a VIP, correct? The second thing is, how about the synchronization? So there will be one dedicated interface between them called sync interface. What will the sync interface do? The sync interface will sync your ARP tables. Will sync state tables and NAT tables plus the other important information. So what will happen is, who is the active here? He is active. Okay. What if I have a host here? This host was passing certain amount of traffic through the active firewall. This host here was passing certain amount of traffic through active firewall, and active firewall is lost. What do I do? Shall I again start my ARP, create state tables, NAT table? In that case, what will happen is, if this guy doesn't become active on time, or even if he becomes active on time, and he doesn't have these ARP tables, and whatever connection was going through this, I have to re-establish those connection. If I have an IP phone call or any connection, that will be reset. all my connections are going to get reset, which is a bad idea. You are not buying such an expensive firewall so that your connection are lost, or hundreds of users in the company will experience, oh, something has failed in the company. You are buying such an expensive solution so that you have high availability all the time. The customer never will come to know that one of the firewall has gone down. That's the purpose of buying a standby firewall. If the customer connection get reset, what is the use of buying a solution like this? Such an expensive solution. Right? So this sync interfaces are the one on which you will have this kind of traffic. So can we say that the cluster interfaces are the data forwarding interfaces? Other data forwarding interfaces. And sync interface is used only for syncing the traffic from active to standby or standby to active, even including the configuration synchronization. Whatever change you do will be synchronized between both. Whatever number of posts or the real data going on, the data stats will be basically whatever ARP entries and state tables and all that will be, so that when active fails, the standby takes over and you will never experience any failover. Correct? So that's the purpose of these cluster interface or sync interface or monitor interface, or you are not monitoring some interfaces also, that's absolutely fine. Maybe your management interface you don't want to monitor, right? That's absolutely fine. So which interface is your cluster interface? And so we'll do it later. Now it's asking which one you want to do for sync also. I'm saying this interface is going to be for synchronization. Now let's put it like that. That's okay to me. One sync, no cluster. Remember that. You know what has happened. See that both the firewalls are gone and the cluster is there. Now they are no more single. They are part of cluster here. Right? And the firewall is not showing, machine status is not available. Why is not available? Because both the firewalls do not have anything to, there are no cluster interfaces on that. Correct? So I'll go to cluster. Now I'm going to, these are my members. This is my, is it high availability or load sharing? You can choose. In load sharing, is it going to be multicast or unicast? You can always move between options here. Okay, you can always use between. If you want to ever switch from active to standby, you can change the priorities of these people as well. These are your members. If you want to decrease or increase anybody's priority, you can do that also. By default, this has higher priority. If you want to change the priority, that's absolutely fine for any of the gateways. You want to add more members, you can add any time you can add more members to this plus particular cluster. I told you up to eight hosts are possible there. Eight gateways are possible there to be part of the single cluster here. Right? The protocol being used is not VRRP. What we are doing today is cluster XL protocol or CCP protocol basically. Network management, my topology is there. What do? I will start working on these interfaces. So this is my external interface. Okay. Should it be a cluster interface or not? It should be, definitely, right? So what is my VIP, virtual IP for this? 12.201/24. So I'm putting at least one cluster interface right now, external, and both gateways are going to get one. Now I will go to the private interface. This is the private interface. And I will edit this one also. It should be part of clustering. Yes, it should be. If you want to do cluster and sync together, that's fine. I'll tell you what are the drawbacks you have. 10.1.1.201, okay, /24. So two interfaces,
What was the message came? Name already used. Please fix the error before attempting to save changes. The name is already changed. Okay. What's that? I have three interfaces. Where did the fourth interface came from? Is it a duplicate? Sure, where it came. This is the private one. And it's going to be cluster again. 10.1.1.201/24. Okay, save the configuration. Okay, we are going to see who's missing. 10.4.2.2.0.1.2.0.0. This is sync, so we are not doing it. These are my cluster members. Okay, CP12 here, I'm missing this. CP12 is 202. Member IPs, I'm missing the second one. 10.1.1.202/24. That's fine because we did VPN yesterday, so there are certain things which are not compatible because of the settings, and these are two different gateways. So we can see that. Now where I'm going to save the configuration, I will not save it to CP1 or CP2. I'm going to have one policy and saved only to the cluster, which means the policy applies to all the members in the as part of the gateway. My policy, install it. You see that what has happened? They have become active. Both are green. The cluster is green and these are also green, which means they are absolutely active. We'll try to save the configuration now. They became red. Policy is successfully installed on the cluster. Now, this is where the problem is. We have to see why it actually became from there to red. You see that? This is the cause for that. This is the cause for that. I'm not sure if I have been disconnected or what. I think I have to unload the policy because the policy got applied. As soon as the policy got applied, it's not working. I think I have to check if I got disconnected also. No, that's working. Okay, installation is failure. Installation should be connectivity to this. Oh, this has failed. TCP connectivity failure, port 18191 has failed to communicate to this particular guy. You see that what has happened basically is that I had only SSH and three protocols were there. Even ICMP was not there. These firewalls are not able to ping each other. Firewalls are not able to ping each other because I implemented a security policy on them not to allow any communication except those three protocols.
Correct. And that policy is basically implemented, is being installed into the all the vendors. So let me check if I individually do something about it. Because once you have a cluster, it will be difficult to install it on a single guy. Anyways, we will go to CLI and unload the policy. One of the gateway is fine. The other gateway got the policy installed in it, and because of that, it has lost the connection or something. If the new policy gets installed on the other one also, CP2, though the policy did not get installed because the CP1 itself, it was lost on that. So our challenge is CP1. So we'll go to CP1. Expert mode. Okay. And FW unload local. What has happened? It's a single word. FW unload local. So uninstalled. Now I'll install the policy again. I'll just go there. Pick up the same standard policy. See that as soon as the policy comes, this guy is still the member. He is fine. This guy has an issue. Solution failed in which member? 11. The CP11 has a problem. Security policy installation canceled and module member of the cluster. Policy installation canceled. Okay. He is part of member. He is part of cluster. Absolutely fine. This guy is not. We are in CP1. I'll just do it again. And I'll just try to reboot it.
queue.
Let's see from my machine, can I ping this guy? I can ping him, so his policies are looking fine. Okay, both members are showing failed. Install the policy. Let me check what are the policies I have. So I have standard policy and new policy. Both are same. Save it to the cluster. CP11 still failed. Okay, CP12 also failed. Okay, what we are going to do is we'll remove these from the cluster. Delete them. Cluster members, remove. Cluster member, remove. Going to add, yes. Okay, in the interfaces it is being used. You have defined the gateway's encryption domain using its valid addresses, but you have not defined these addresses. Define valid address by editing the interface in the network management tab. Okay. Gateway's encryption domain using its valid addresses, but you have not defined these addresses. To define valid address of everything in the network management tab. Why will I do that when I've removed? Okay, I'm going to remove these. Remove them. That. Okay. CP 11. And 7216.200. Okay. Okay, both these gateways are there, and we have to re-establish SIC again, CP config. Disable cluster membership is not required. Number 5, secure general communication. Do you want to reinitialize? Yes, you want to do that? Yeah. Cisco 123. Cisco 123. Okay, so now we'll go to CP 2. Config.
number 5. Okay. Okay, this guy's SICK is established. Go to CP12. Try to establish SICK. Okay. We'll go to cluster again. We will try to add these existing gateways, CP11. Done. And CP12. It's a high availability. And we will try to get the interfaces with topology information. Okay, we've got it. Okay, so the problem with these interfaces you see here is this is CP1, CP2. Good is correct because the names are correct, and there I think there was some problem with the name, so it has picked up two interfaces because of that. The names have to be exactly same for both the interfaces. See, that's where the problem is, because here it's fine. These two ETH2 that we are getting is basically because of Gaia. I think I've given two different names to these people. I'm going to change that so that they have exactly same name. Internet, is there any name given? Inside, outside, inside. Okay. We'll go to the second one. Outside and inside, that is correct. So how is it pulling these both interfaces? Check inside, there's something wrong. That's the reason it's picking up like two times. Ten one one 200 inside up. Okay, and we go back to this one. So inside 202 is, names are absolutely correct. This is private, okay, ETH1 and ETH2. Why is it ETH2 coming two times? Not able to understand it. Is it going to be a private interface? I'm fine with it, even if it is a private interface, but CP1's address is not given. 172.16.2.200. Sorry, 10.1.1.2. Okay, I got it. So the problem that we have in both the gateways is they were not on the same subnet. So I'm going to change it to this because they had private subnets which were different, right? So they had private gateways because we did VPN lab yesterday and we kept them on different subnet because that was representing one site. This is 10.1.2.0 and this is 1.0. Okay, so because of that, this is 1.0. So this has to be 2.0. Because now they are going to become part of same cluster. So they are going to be on the same location. Yesterday, the practical we did is they are going to be at two different locations. You define the gateway's encryption domain using its valid addresses, but you have not defined these addresses. Define this is okay. So this is anyways is going to be sync. So I may or may not do that. This is going to be my cluster. So I have to define a plus private IP 10.4.12.2.0.1.24 defined. This is again going to be kind of cluster, so it is basically, or it could be cluster sync both. Cluster and sync, I'll say both, that's fine. 10.1.2.2.0.1.24. This may or may not act as sync management. I'll not keep it because it's risky. So I'm not defining any virtual IP for this. This is defined. This is defined 10.4.1.2.2.0.1. VPN, I'm not doing anything right now with anything to do with VPN. And now I'll check my policy, which should permit all protocols at this time. Otherwise, it will block it. Taking some abnormal time, that is not a good sign. Okay, I want to see the status of the gateways, which is both showing red at this time, and I'll just try to save the policy here, standard policy. Installation failed on the cluster. Peer 6 certificate has been revoked, right, to reset SIG on the peer and reestablish their trust. Same thing as peer 6 certificate has been revoked, right, to reset SIG on the peer and reestablish for both of these guys. Okay. Fail to connect, test the SIG status. try to reset SYC on the peer and reestablish the trust. Okay. This is done in this one. Communication seems to be fine, but we'll still see. Trust is established. Trust is established. Okay, guys, this is a very good testing. When you see this, that your server has been recognized, like CP1, there is an issue, but CP2 is recognized, CP12 is recognized. That means its CPU status and other things will be visible. Like these are visible here now. Okay, that means things are actually fine. It just after loading the configuration, things can become fine after that. The problem comes when you don't see these two stats. Okay, now the installation is done. In couple of seconds, this should be all good. So this is a very good way of checking the things here. Let's see our configuration. This was the thing, source any, destination any, accepted, checkpoint gateway. It should be fine. It should take a couple of seconds to come back. And if it is not coming back, but it's taking the configuration, that means we have some problem with the topology. Yeah, so external, I am using cluster. Okay. Internal, I am using cluster and sync. So at least one cluster and one interface cluster and sync is there. So it's all good. You can, I think it should be both. One has come. It generally takes a couple of seconds for this to show as member of this, so it is part of the cluster and it's active and everything else is fine. This should also be, there is a cluster Excel problem. Let's see what is the problem. Trust, I think, was fine. We established it, but does it require SYC status? Is fine, it's communicating. Okay. Interfaces. So I'll go back to this one, CP1, or we will do SSH. Configuration was saved correctly, so there is no point in having any error. I'm not sure what is it. So this is member of clustering and it's working fine. This one has a problem, CP12. Communication is established. Let's go back to this. CP2. 202 is virtual IP, 200.202 seems to be okay. Let's check what is the command here. CPHA probe. State. Okay, one is active, that's taking because it's a high availability. So one is taking 100%, the second one is showing down. Let's see what are the other options we have here. CP config. So clustering is enabled, that is fine. I'm just going to reboot this to see if, okay, I think I made a mistake. I rebooted the CP1, which was working fine. I should have rebooted the second firewall, which is this. Now I'm rebooting the second firewall. Okay, let's see what's going on here. Cluster member status. Actually, in the CLI, it was showing fine. Let's check what is the problem with this guy here. Okay, member is standby, so he is fine. 2 minutes, 15 second, and it's active up, CP12. Member state is standby, so he is not with us. Let's go back to this guy again to see what is his problem. So he is active and he is fine. I don't know why it is showing red here. So I'll just go and check what is the, it shouldn't show red because there is no point of seeing that here. I'm just going to SSH again. Okay. Now it is showing fine. So we rebooted it and after that it became fine. Okay. Now because it is a high availability state, right? You can see that because it is a high availability state, one is going to be active, the all others are going to be standby. Simple process. Right now we are going to change it, this particular thing, to the load balancing to see what changes basically happens there. Okay, but for load balancing also we should have more than two gateways, basically generally two or more, so that will make more sense. And you can see this is the local one, this is the IP, he is assigned 100% load, the other guy is just sitting in the standby. If active fails, the standby takes over. That is the role of standby. So do not go by these message here, because this monitor thing is more important to see. And here it is showing that your stuff is all good. You are standby. It's all clustering is working. Firewall is working. Other things, if you have configured anything, it will show you. If you have enabled monitoring blade, it will show you what kind of traffic. And it is also showing CPU and RAM related stats and all those things. So here is the firewall status. Now what we will do is we are going to change the mode of the clustering. So I'll go to cluster members, and I'm going to change it to load sharing. Okay, so I'll change it to load sharing, multicast mechanism. Shall I do multicast or not? That's a point. They are on the same subnet, but I am not sure if on VMware adapters it will take multicast. So I will not choose that because I do not have a physical switch connected there. And I don't want to take that kind of risk. So I'm just opting for load sharing, but unicast mechanism. There is a, you know, warning related to license. I can see that, but no problems about the clustering as such. The warning is related to the licenses or something else. So I just changed it from high availability to load sharing, and we will see the status of our firewalls to see the gateways. And you see that here it has come to the load sharing now. It was anyways active. We will go to monitoring mode to see what has changed. It is active now. Both are active. This guy is active and this guy is also active. He is also active. So both are active. Correct. So that red mark, it was showing that it is not active. That is what it was showing. It was standby. So it was showing as that was not essentially an error.
Okay, guys, that was not an error. That was just a that it is in standby mode, because you when you click on the monitor, you can see the right stuff, what's going on. Now I have this thing here. Again, I want to check the stats. Now you see that both are active. The first gateway, which is pivot, right? Because it's a unicast mode. Remember that. In unicast, there is a pivot mode. So 30% is assigned, and the second one is 70%, because he is doing actively the job of boss to designate the traffic to other people also, and the management related functions. So he is taking less active data forwarding traffic because he is involved into management functions, and he is giving it to the 70% to everybody else. I can go and change that priority at any point of time to change my clustering properties. So if CP11 right now is the pivot, right? I can anytime change, decrease his priority, and I'm not sure if it will take place just like that. I will just see that. If they change their position of active and standby or pivot, and you know this one. Guys, if you do not have a solid, you know, base of this, please do practicals of HSRP and VRRP once, so that you have a good idea of, you know, what are the monitoring interfaces, how does this thing work in the background. In GNS, you can do that practically, because those fundamentals are very important to understand this. It's all happening in graphical tool. We may not be able to see a lot of stuff. But once you do on Cisco devices, you will have a strong fundamental. Okay, successful. And we will go back again to see what are the changes that has happened. Right, what was it? The first guy was pivot. Now he is, the IP address is not shown, or what is it? Yeah, so the first guy is now, the local guy is active, right? And this guy who used to be pivot, who was pivot? Who was the boss? 10.11.200. He is no more the boss. He is no more than those, because we change the membership, we change the relationship, right? We decrease the priority of this guy. So he is no more the boss. Correct? When you are implementing multicasting, make sure you have a switch down there on internal and external interfaces which support IGMP or multicasting. If you do not have multicasting supported on the underlying network, do not implement multicasting on the checkpoint firewall for clustering. Now in real world, definitely everybody will have it, and all Cisco switches by default have CGMP and IGMP enabled. Okay, especially IGMP enabled is an open standard now, so there should not be any problem related to these kind of things. But if you're doing on VMware, make sure you have multicasting enabled in VMware on those interfaces, or on your vSwitch rather, I'll say. Okay, guys, that's all for the clustering. Any questions that we have? Right, you've seen the troubleshooting also. If you get stuck, you know how to basically overcome that. You have to re-establish the SIC. You have to reboot the devices in case of problems, and that's all. Those are the two tricks. Use CP config as the best trick, basically. Guys, any question, any doubt that we have on this?
I'm not able to hear anything, so I take it as everything is good. Okay, so I'll see you in the next class on next Saturday about intrusion prevention system, IPS, threat detection, geolocation filtering, and other stuff. All right, guys, you take care. I'll see you in the next weekend then.